हेलो ऑल, वेलकम टू द थर्ड एंड द लास्ट पार्ट ऑफ द चैप्टर इंट्रोडक्शन टू इकोलॉजी। इन दिस पार्ट वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी वेरियस टर्म्स दैट आर यूज्ड इन इकोलॉजी, स्टार्टिंग विद द फर्स्ट टर्म दैट इज जेनेटिक डाइवर्सिटी। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विद द डेफिनेशन ऑफ जेनेटिक डाइवर्सिटी। सो वॉट इज जेनेटिक डाइवर्सिटी? It is the variation in the amount of genetic information within and among individuals of a population, a species, an assemblage or a community. Or in other words, we can say the total number of genetic characteristics in the genetic makeup of a species is known as genetic diversity. Now, what is the nature and origin of genetic variations? So genetic variation, it is a measure of genetic differences that exist within a population. So in a population, the gene makeup of a species, it may vary. So this makes up the genetic variations. The genetic variation of an entire species is often called as genetic diversity. So whatever variation we see in an entire species is generally called as the genetic diversity. So there are differences in DNA segments or genes between individuals, and each variation of a gene is generally called as an allele. So even the species is same, even though the differences can be seen in the DNA segments or the genes present on the DNA, and such variation or such what we can say a difference in the DNA segment is called as the allele. It is very essential for natural selection, because natural selection can only increase or decrease frequency of alleles that already exist in the population. It is mainly caused due to mutation, random mating between organisms, random fertilization, crossing over or recombination between chromatids of homologous chromosomes during meiosis. Then the next term used in ecology is species diversity. So the definition of species diversity is the number of species and abundance of each species that live in a particular location. So the total number of species present in a particular location is called as the species diversity, and the number of species that live in a certain location is called as the species richness. So the number of that species in a particular location is also referred to as species richness. Then the origin of species diversity. The fossil records, they are very important sources to analyze the history of diversity through geological time, as well as it also gives clues to the origin of this diversity. So whatever diversity we see today on the planet Earth, it has been evolved from certain organisms, and these relations, they can be studied with the help of the fossil records. The fossil records, they provide us enough information to understand ancient biodiversity in terms of taxonomic richness, especially at higher taxonomic levels. So fossil records, they are very important, as they are helpful for us to understand what plants were present in the ancient times. Then these also permit historical reconstruction of the origins of modern biodiversity. It also reveals biotic events with reference to evolutionary radiations and mass extinction. The fossil diversity is measured for family and generic diversity rather than species diversity, as the concept of fossil species is not equivalent to the concept of a living one. So generally the fossil diversity, it is generally restricted to the family and genus level, but not to the species level, because the fossil species, they are not equivalent to the living specimens. Then the two factors that are believed to be responsible for the continual rise in the number of plant species during the evolution of planet Earth are, first factor, it was the initial breakup of Pangaea and subsequently of Gondwanaland. So as we all know, initially the land part, which we call as different continents. In previously it was a combined land, but after during the time of evolution it was just broken up into Pangaea and the Gondwana land. Due to this major separation of land masses, the evolution of plant life, it took place on the earth, and thus several new species were produced and they became continental endemics. This was particularly took place in the Cenozoic era. Then the second factor is the evolution of different plant communities within each of these land masses favored speciation at a very rapid rate. Then the next term, which is widely used in ecology, is the diversity indices. So what is a diversity index? A diversity index is a mathematical measure of species diversity in a given community. So it is a mathematical measure by which we can calculate the species diversity in a given community. So it is mainly based on both the species richness and species abundance, where the species richness is also called as the number of species present in that particular area, and species abundance is nothing but the number of individuals per species. So how many individuals of a particular species are present is called as the species abundance. So the area which has the highest number of species is considered as the highly diverse area. Then these indices, they are of two types. First one is the dominance indices and second is the information statistic indices. The dominance indices, it is weighed towards the abundance of the commonest species, and a widely used dominance index is the Simpson's diversity index. It generally takes into account both species richness and species evenness. So these two factors, they are measured under the Simpson's diversity index. And the second one is the information statistic indices, in which it takes into account the rare species in a community. It is based on the rationale that diversity in a natural system can be measured in a way that is similar to the way information contained in a code or message is measured. Then the next term is the species abundance. Species abundance is the number of individuals per species, and relative abundance refers to the evenness of distribution of individuals among species in a community. So the total number of individuals of a particular species is called as the species abundance, and the relative abundance is the evenness or the pattern of distribution of the species in a community. Then the next term which we are going to study is the ecosystem diversity. Now what do you mean by ecosystem? So ecosystem, it is defined as the variety of different ecosystems within an area. So there are different ecosystems which are present on the planet, and the variation in these ecosystems is called as the ecosystem diversity. Now in the world there are few major types of ecosystems which we are going to study one by one, out of which the first major ecosystem type is the tropical moist forest. The tropical moist forest, they are also referred as rainforest or the tropical forest, and these two words, they are usually used as synonyms. This type of forest, they are mainly found between the Tropic of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn. This type of forest, they extend from South Mexico to the east coast of Brazil in the African continent. Such forests are present only along the coast of Geneva in the Zaire Basin and in the eastern region of Madagascar. In Asian continent, they are found on the southern slopes of eastern Himalayas in southwest India, that is the Western Ghats, Sri Lanka, Malaysia, Indonesia, Philippines, Thailand and New Geneva. In Australia, they are confined to a very small narrow strip on the eastern coast. Then the second type of ecosystem is the temperate forest. The temperate forest, they mainly occur in the northern hemisphere. They are found in the continents of Europe, Eastern Asia, North America, South America, New Zealand, Tasmania, Western Europe, Eastern USA and Canada. This forest, they are dominated by deciduous hardwood trees and to a lesser extent evergreen broadleaf hardwood trees and the conifers. Now what are deciduous plants? These are the plants which shed their leaves in a specific season, and the evergreen plants are the plants which have leaves all over the year. Both these type of plants, they are found in the temperate forest, and even the conifers. Conifers are the group of plants which mainly grows in at an higher altitude. Then approximately around 1200 species are reported in this type of forest, although Eastern Asia is most diverse with the largest number of species. Then the third type of ecosystem is the arid and semi-arid ecosystems. The biological diversity in these ecosystems is rather very poor and is influenced by water availability. As the name itself indicates, arid and semi-arid, these are the regions with scarcity of the water. So depending upon the water availability, the ecosystem, it is rather poor in case of the biological diversity. Then the precipitation, it is extremely unpredictable in this area. So many a times the rainfall, it is very low and it is unpredictable. Then it also comprises of drought offending, enduring and resisting taxa. So the taxa or the plants which are able to resist the drought are often seen or often grow in these areas. Then the next type of ecosystem is the boreal type of forest. This boreal forest, they are defined as forest growing in high latitude environments where freezing temperatures occur for 6 to 8 months. So around 6 to 8 months of the year, this forest, they are covered with the snow and they have freezing temperatures. These biomes, they are also very poor in terms of species richness, but the function and diversity of the component species is very high in this type of forest. The next type of ecosystem is the Arctic and Alpine systems. The Arctic systems, they are dominated ecosystems which are devoid of trees. They occupy about 8% of the terrestrial surface of the earth, with 5% in the Arctic region and 3% in the Alpine. These ecosystems, they support about 4% of the earth's flora, with 1500 species in the Arctic zone and around 10,000 species in the Alpine zone. The next major ecosystem type is the grasslands. Grasslands, they form natural vegetation on the land surface of the earth. These forms are open type of vegetation, often subjected to periods of drought. They constitute the largest category of generally non-tilled but extensively used land across the world. This ecosystem is dominated by grass and grass-like species. Mostly the grasslands, they are known by different names throughout the world. For example, they are called as steppes in Eurasia, prairies in North America, Cerrados in Pampas, in South America, savannas in Africa, and rangelands in Australia. So mainly these are the large open surfaces which are usually covered with the different types of grasses. Then the next type of ecosystem is the wetland ecosystem. This type of ecosystem, it covers a wide range of inland, coastal and marine habitats. So whatever water bodies we have inside the land, the coastal areas and the marine habitats, all these are included under wetland ecosystems. Wetlands, these are the areas of marsh, peatland or water, whether natural or maybe artificial, permanent or temporary, with water that may be static or flowing, fresh, brackish or salty. So basically any water reservoir can be included under wetland ecosystems, whether it may be a natural source of water, it may be artificial source, it may be temporary or permanent, water may be free flowing or water may be static, even the marine or the fresh water. So any type of water reservoir, it can be included in the wetland ecosystems. Then the next type of ecosystem is the freshwater wetlands. As the name itself indicates, it is also a wetland, but it is comprised of the fresh water. So as we all know, only 0.014% of earth water occurs in the soils and as freshwater wetlands. This includes sphagnum, mosses, some species from Western Ghats such as Myristica, etc. Then the next ecosystem is the marine type of ecosystem. These are considered to be the habitats that complete the large system from the shores to the dark sea floor. So from the coastal area to the deep dark sea floors, all the region, it is included under the marine ecosystems. The marine ecosystem includes marshes, tidal zones, estuaries, the mangrove forests, lagoons, seagrass beds, the sea floor and the coral reefs. So all these, they are included under marine type of ecosystems. Then the next type of ecosystem is the agro ecosystems. So this, up till 9th, or the marine ecosystems, all the ecosystems, they were the natural type of ecosystems. But this agro ecosystem, it is one of the artificial type of ecosystem, and which is very essential for the primary needs of mankind. So whatever agricultural system we have, humans have developed, can be included under the agro ecosystem, and it is an artificial type of ecosystem. This system, it largely depends on the intensity of human intervention. So the human or anthropological activities, they are very important to for these agro ecosystems. Then this ecosystem, it also includes shifting type of cultivation, home and kitchen gardens, pastures, mixed farming, multiple cropping, horticulture, orchid plantations, etc. So whatever activities by which the human beings, they plant the trees, all these activities, they are included under the agro ecosystems. Now, one of the very important topics is the hotspots in India. Now, what is a hotspot? So, a biodiversity hotspot, it is a biogeographic region with significant levels of biodiversity that is threatened by human habitation. So, basically, it is a region which has a very high biodiversity, but at the same time, it is threatened due to the anthropological activities or by the human interference. So India, it is one of the recognized mega diverse countries, which is very rich in biodiversity, and it is also associated with traditional knowledge. India has around 23.39% of its geographical area under forest and tree cover. With just 2.4% of the land area, India accounts nearly 7% of the recorded species. In terms of species richness, India ranks 7th in mammals, 9th in birds and 5th in reptiles. In terms of endemism of vertebrate groups, India's position is 10th in birds with 69 species, 5th in reptiles with 156 species and 7th in amphibians with 110 species. India's share is 44% as compared to the world average of 11%. Then there are mainly four biodiversity hotspots which are recognized in India. The first out of these four are the Himalayas. So the Himalayan region, it includes the entire Indian Himalayan region that falls in Pakistan, Tibet, Nepal, Bhutan, China, as well as in Myanmar. The second region is the Indo-Burma region. It includes entire northeastern India except Assam and Andaman group of islands, along with Myanmar, Thailand, Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia and southern China. The third biodiversity hotspot in India are the Western Ghats. It includes the entire Western Ghats along with Sri Lanka. So the Western Ghats in India specifically, they start from the state of Gujarat, Maharashtra, Goa, Karnataka, Kerala. Okay, so all these states, they come under the Western Ghats in India. And the fourth biodiversity hotspot in India are the Sunda lands. This includes the Nicobar group of islands, including Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, Brunei, and Philippines. Now, what is the basic concept and basis of hotspot identification? So, in the year 1988, British ecologist Norman Myers, he published a seminal paper identifying 10 tropical forest hotspots. So these were the regions which were characterized both by exceptional level of plant endemism and serious levels of habitat loss. So basically, these are the regions in which there are so many plants which are endemic, as well as at the same time they are also threatened. Okay, what is endemism? Endemism means a plant which is native to a specific place and it is not found anywhere else in the world. So these plants, they are endemic plants, and as well as in the biodiversity hotspot, these plants, they are at a serious level of threat or serious level of loss. And to qualify as a hotspot, a region must support 1500 endemic plant species, which is 0.5% of the total global species. So if a area is to be declared as a biodiversity hotspot, the region, it should at least have 1500 endemic plant species. Okay, and the existing primary vegetation is the basis for assessing human impact in a region. So whatever primary vegetation is present in an area, it is the basis for assessing human impact in a region. So according to the number of the plant species present in a specific area, one can easily conclude whether the human, what is the human impact of human impact on the vegetation of that particular area. To qualify as a hotspot, a region must have lost more than 70% of its native original vegetation or the habitat. So not only the area, it should support 1500 endemic plants, but along with that, the area, if it has lost around 70% of its original vegetation, then also the area can be declared as a biodiversity hotspot. So with this, we come to the end of our chapter. I hope the lecture was useful for you all. Thank you.